The Frog King or Ian Henry by the Brothers Grimm. In old times, when wishing still helped one, there lived a king whose daughters were all beautiful. But the youngest was so beautiful that the sun itself, which had seen so much, was astonished whenever it shone in her face. Close by the king's castle lay a great dark forest, and under an old lime tree in the forest was a well. And when the days was very warm, the king's child went out into the forest and sat down by the side of the cool fountain. And when she was dull, she took a golden ball and threw it up on high and caught it. And this ball was her favorite plaything. Now it so happened that on one occasion, the princess's golden ball did not fall into the little hand which she was holding up for it, but on the ground beyond and rolled straight into the water. The king's daughter followed it with her eyes, but it vanished. And then the well was so deep the bottom could not be seen. On this, she began to cry, and cry louder and louder, and could not be comforted. And as she thus lamented, someone said to her, "What ails thee, king's daughter? Thou weepest so that even a stone would show pity." She looked round to the side from whence the voice came, and saw a frog stretching forth to its thick, ugly head from the water. "Ah, old water splasher, is it thou?" said she. "I am weeping for my golden ball, which has fallen into the well." "Be quiet and do not weep," answered the frog. "I can help thee. But what wilt thou give me if I bring thy plaything up again?" "Whatever thou wilt have, dear frog," said she. "My clothes, my pearls and jewels, and even the golden crown where I am wearing." The frog answered, "I do not care for thy clothes, thy pearls and thy jewels, or the golden crown. But if thou wilt love me, and let me be thy companion and playfellow, and sit by thee at thy little table, and eat off the little golden plate, and drink out of thy little cup, and sleep in thy little bed, if thou wilt promise me this, I will go down below and bring thee thy golden ball up again." "Oh yes," said she, "I promise thee all thou wish, if thou wilt but bring me back my ball again." She, however, thought, "How the silly frog does talk. He lives in the water with the other frogs and croaks and can be no companion to any human being." But the frog, when he had received his promise, put his head into the water and sank down, and a short while came swimming up again with a ball in his mouth and threw it on the grass. The king's daughter was delighted to see her pretty plaything once more, and picked it up and ran away with it. "Wait, wait," said the frog, "take me with thee. I can run as thou canst." But what did it avail him to scream his croak after her as loudly as he could? She did not listen to it, but ran home and soon forgot the poor frog, who was forced to go back into his well again. The next day, when she had seated herself at the table with the king and all the courtiers and was eating from her little golden plate, something came creeping, splish splash up the marble staircase, and when it had got on the top, it knocked at the door and cried, "Princess, youngest princess, open the door for me." She ran to see who was outside. When she opened the door, she saw the frog in front of it. And then she slammed the door to, in great haste, sat down to dinner again and was quite frightened. The king saw plainly that her heart was beating violently and said, "My child, what art thou so afraid of? Is there perchance a giant outside who wants to carry thee away?" "Ah, no," replied she, "it is not a giant, but a disgusting frog." "What does a frog want with thee?" "Ah, dear father, yesterday, as I was in the forest, sitting by the well, playing my golden ball, fell into the water. And because I cried so, the frog brought it out again for me. And because he insisted, I promised him he should be my companion. But I never thought he would be able to come out of his water. And now he is outside there and wants me to come in to me." In the meantime, it knocked a second time and cried, "Princess, youngest princess, open the door for me. Dost thou know what thou saidst to me? Yesterday, by the cool waters of the fountain, princess, youngest princess, open the door for me." Then said the king, "That which thou hast promised me thou perform. Go and let him in." She went and opened the door, and the frog hopped in and followed her, step by step, to her chair. There he sat and cried, "Lift me up beside thee." She delayed until at last the king commanded her to do it. When the frog was once on the chair, he wanted to be on the table, and when he was on the table, he said, "Now push the little golden plate nearer me, and we may eat together." She did this, but it was easy to see that she did not do this willingly. The frog enjoyed what he ate, but he almost every mouthful she took choked her. At length he said, "I have eaten and I am satisfied. Now I am tired. Carry me into the little room and make that little silken bed ready, and we will both lie down and go to sleep." The king's daughter began to cry, for she was afraid of the cold frog, which she did not like to touch, and which was now to sleep in her pretty clean little bed. But the king grew angry and said, "He who helped thee when thou wert in trouble ought not afterwards to be despised by thee." So she took hold of the frog with two fingers, carried him upstairs, and put him in a corner. But when she was in bed, he crept to her and said, "I am tired. I want to sleep as well as thou. Lift me up, or I will tell thy father." Then she was terribly angry, and took him up and threw him with all her might against the wall. "Now thou wilt be quiet, odious frog," said she. But when he fell down, he was no frog, but a king's son, with beautiful kind eyes. He, by her father's will, was now her dear companion and husband. Then he told her how he had been bewitched by a wicked witch, and how no one could have delivered him from the well but herself, and that tomorrow they would go together into his kingdom. Then they went to sleep, and next morning, when the sun awoke them, a carriage came driving up with 8 white horses, which had white ostrich feathers on their heads, were harnessed with gold chains, and behind stood the king's young faithful servant, Faithful Henry. Faithful Henry had been so unhappy when his master was changed into a frog that he had caused 3 iron bands to be laid round his heart, lest it should be burst with grief and sadness. The carriage was to conduct the king into his kingdom. Faithful Henry helped them both in and placed himself behind again, and was full joy of his deliverance. And when they had driven a part of the way, the king's son heard a cracking behind him, as if something had broken. So he turned round and cried, "Henry, the carriage is breaking." "No, master, it is not the carriage. It is a band from my heart, which was put in there by great pain, when you were a frog and imprisoned in the well." And once again, while they were on their way, something cracked, and each time the king's son thought the carriage was breaking, but it was only the bands which were springing from the heart of Faithful Henry, because his master was set free and happy.